All right, Hacksters, we're here at Arm TechCon with Laurent Etty. Is that how you say it?
Yes.
Yeah, awesome.
Pretty good.
And you're presenting Jevois?
Yes.
So could you give us a quick description of what Jevois is and how you get it?
Okay, so Jevois is a very small camera that has a quad-core ARM processor inside. And so the idea is that the camera not only can take pictures, but it can also interpret what it sees. So instead of just showing you a picture and leaving all the interpretation work to your brain, it can tell you that there is an elephant in the picture, or a person, a car, and that's something that if you're building a robot, you would be able to use directly from the camera.
Amazing. And that's smaller than my regular camera, and it has a fan in it?
Yes, it has a fan because there is actually quite a bit of computing power inside this. It's roughly the equivalent of an iPad. And you may have noticed as soon as you start running something serious on your iPad, it gets so hot that you can't hold it anymore. Huh. So here we put a fan so that we don't have that that problem. So you can run the camera. Usually we run the processor at full load, and so the fan is necessary so that it doesn't overheat.
Cool. What is the processor that's sucking up all that energy?
So it's a Qualcomm ARM. It's 1.3 gigahertz. So it allows you to run simple algorithms like the one that we are seeing in the background here. This is detecting tags. That one is running at about 100 frames per second on that on the processor. And you can even run more complex algorithms like deep neural networks that can recognize 1,000 different objects. And those can still run at about 30 frames per second on that quad-core processor.
What kind of objects are you looking to detect?
So with 1,000 categories, it's a really broad collection. This is from a standard data set called ImageNet. It goes from, you know, elephants to people to chopsticks to, you know, pliers. So yeah, 1,000 different things.
Have you ever put anything in front of it that I couldn't figure
out? Oh yes, yes. So the performance of those things is far from being 100% accurate. Uh-huh. So often you put something in front of it, and it tells you, oh, this is a kite, but it was not a kite at all.
Oh no.
So deep learning is still, you know, work in progress. Especially the networks that we run on this camera, they are somewhat optimized for speed. So they are not going to be 100% accurate. They are more going to be on the order of 50%. So, you know, 50-50 chance that it will be correct depending on which object you shoot. For some objects, they do really well, like cars and people. Those are very reliable, but objects that are rare or that have very different appearances don't work as well.
So you're probably saving some processing power because you're not using the internet. Is that correct? It doesn't use the internet?
Yes. So this is a standalone device. We have actually some of the customers that are using this just with like a battery powered, and the device can, you know, you can, for example, in a surveillance scenario, capture video. The processor can then detect are there people or particular things that you may be interested in. And when you detect those events, you just save the results. There is a micro SD card in the camera, so you can save the results. So you can be completely, you know, out in the middle of nowhere, and you can leave that as a smart surveillance system. And you come back once in a while and check out whether it recorded some interesting events.
And it probably doesn't even take that much space if you're just storing like descriptions, right?
Yes. So you can store descriptions. We have actually an application that each time it finds an interesting event, it will store the description. It can also text it to you. So you would need for that to connect it to a cell phone.
Cool.
to send the text. The camera itself doesn't send the text, but in principle, you know, the data is available to send us the text. And we can also save like maybe 10 seconds of video around that event. So it's a very compact indeed, like you said, you know, you could save a lot of those before you run out of space.
So you can deploy it in the field and record all kinds of stuff. What kinds of cool applications are people doing with this?
So there are many robotics applications. Uh-huh. We have actually customers that are from all over the place, ranging from, you know, Google and Amazon. They are doing some top secret things, I'm sure, with that, to even Dyson. Of course, a lot of universities and research labs.
Do you think Dyson's making their own Roomba?
They might. Oh. They might want to add vision to some of their products.
I don't know. A big bowl.
We don't know, but yeah, they are not going to tell you. So a lot of universities and government labs, NASA, for example, had, you know, many of the NASA offices have bought this camera. We just had a gentleman from the Stanford Linear Accelerator who is looking for some machine vision to try to help, you know, in environments where humans cannot go because there is too much radiation.
Wow.
So you could send this, it's very inexpensive, you know, if you destroy it, then it's okay.
Yeah.
Same thing, you know, you could send this on a rover for space exploration. It's very light, it's only 17 grams, so half an ounce roughly.
It's not a lot of weight or money cost.
Yes, so some of the customers are like this, the people who are interested in this. But it's kind of a bimodal distribution, so those are sophisticated users. And we have also a lot of startup companies that are in this segment. And then we have also the kids. So we have a lot of students who are participating in the first robotics.
Kids.
Yeah, and they are looking for adding machine vision. There is more and more of a push towards autonomy in this challenge, but the machine vision solutions are a little bit restricted right now. So this is something where we have actually helped several teams. You can program the camera in Python, and you know, OpenCV is already on there, so you don't have to install anything. You just connect it, and you can start writing your code in Python and OpenCV, you know, right away.
Super cool. And have you thought about using it for any personal projects?
Yes, yes. So I have some personal projects. Actually, that smart surveillance thing,
uh-huh.
I have some of those running.
In your house?
Not in my house, but in remote locations.
Uh-huh.
So where the camera is just battery powered, and there is a solar panel that recharges the battery during the day.
Cool.
And then it's just looking for surprising events. And when it finds something surprising, it will record 30 seconds of you know, around that event to the SD card.
So what counts as surprising?
So this is something that we have developed in my lab a few years ago, a Bayesian theory of surprise. So this is in my research lab at USC now. It's not, you know, only on Jovo. So the idea was that you don't know what surprising means, right? Surprising is a concept, you use it every day, but we don't have a quantitative way of defining surprise, right? We don't have a unit of surprise. If I ask you, was, you know, 9/11 more surprising than Trump winning the election? You don't know which one, right? Because you cannot put a number on those things. So yes, a few years ago, and this is work with Pierre Baldi at University of California, Irvine, we developed a mathematical theory of surprise, where we can measure surprise by basically the difference in your internal beliefs before and after you observed something.
Whoa.
So if I believe that there is a 10% chance of rain tomorrow, and then I observe a big cloud in the sky, and that forces me to revise my belief to a 20% chance of rain tomorrow. That chance from 10% to 20% would create one wow of surprise. This is our unit. Okay, so, and the wow is very similar to the way in which Shannon defined the bit. So the bit of information, and so in parallel to that, we have that unit of the wow of surprise. Okay.
You've changed my belief about how machines detecting surprise works.
Exactly.
It's all about novelty, but
it's a bunch of wows when you
laughed.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yes. So that's actually the key element, which is that. Surprise. Well, definition of surprise is very different from Shannon's definition of information. It's focused on the subjective observer and not so much on the data. So the data, which was the observation of the cloud, is just here to change you as an observer, and this is what creates surprise. So surprise is an inherently subjective quantity. So we have a surprise algorithm that runs in this camera, believe it or not, which is based on that theory that we published research
cool.
papers.
Do you have surprise benchmarks for like known events again, it's subjective.
Yes, exactly, it's subjective, so it all depends, you know, if you knew, if you were part of the Trump electoral you know, team, and you had high confidence that you were going to win, then it was a smaller surprise for you. But if you were on the Clinton Clinton team, that or you know, all of the media, they got kind of you know, really surprised by this. So one way in which we can test this quantitatively is we have people watch TV, and we track their eyes. So as you are watching TV. You're just using a high-speed camera, actually there is also an eye-tracking algorithm on this, so just using this camera, looking at your eye, I can know where you are looking, okay? So once we have that, we hypothesize that if we show surprising things, like for example, a person enters the room, a light turns on, that people would use this kind of surprise measure and go look at those things. So we did a direct comparison in which we can compute surprise on the TV. So using our theory and using our mass, we can detect, we can decide which things are surprising according to the theory, and then we could check, do people, regular humans, do they tend to look at those surprising things? And indeed, they were very attracted towards those surprising things that the theory predicted were surprising.
It's interesting because this guy does some emotion detection, but it's all based on facial gestures. Mm-hmm. Which I guess eyes are also a gesture, but like it's not like an expression. It's like not based on that at all. It's a totally different way of measuring surprise.
Yes, yes. So we measure surprise as, I guess, we believe as it's being computed in your brain, and then your facial expressions will be the result of that, of that surprise. And so that's what your robots can then detect.
Yeah. That'd be so cool. Right now he runs on a Raspberry Pi. So yeah, what exactly is this demo doing that you're showing?
So in this demo, the camera, which you cannot see, there is a camera here that is tracking. It's just detecting and tracking that little marker. This is the marker that often we use for robotics projects. You can, for example, you can put a marker like that on the back of a car, and then another car can follow your car just by detecting this marker. There is actually a dictionary, so there are, depending on the dictionary, it goes from between 50 different markers. That pattern has 50 different ones, but yeah, you can create as many as you want.
Does it mean anything? Like, to me it looks like a snail, but...
no, it doesn't mean anything. To me it looks like a smiley face.
Oh yeah.
They don't mean anything. They were created so that from one to the next, they are very different. So there is as little confusion that is possible. So even if you are missing a piece of it, you know, your chances of detecting the correct one is still going to be good. So in this case, the camera is just detecting this thing, and without any external computer, it's just controlling the pan tilt head.
Wow.
That you can see here, so that the camera will just follow and track that.
And the Arduino Pro Micro is controlling the servo?
Exactly, so the Arduino Pro Micro is receiving the messages from the camera that is telling it, you know, move left by that much, and then it's just generating the pulses from the servo.
Cool! And that's just kind of doing like a random pattern?
Exactly, so that robot is just, you know, exercising, mm-hmm. and the camera is just making sure, do all your push-ups and...
I need that.
We will see who breaks first, you know, is it going to be the robot or the pan tilt? Pan tilt motors.
What's next for Joie?
What's next? So we are expanding the line. Right now the next release is going to be a sensor. This is in about maybe a week or two, as soon as we have time to finish the, you know, the software development. Uh-huh. So it's basically a mod from the original camera. I don't know if you can see it here. We have a sensor which has a global shutter. 1.3 megapixel, the same resolution as the original.
Oh, nice.
And there is also an IMU. And the IMU has been precisely lined up with the sensor. So the optical axis of the sensor is the on the axis of the IMU.
Nice.
And the IMU is 9 degrees of freedom, so you have three accelerations, three rotation velocities, and also a magnetometer, a three-axis magnetometer. So this is very nice so that, for example, in drones, usually, you know, they have a bunch of cameras and then they have a bunch of IMUs. Now everything is, again, self-contained. As the camera is moving, the accelerometers in the IMU are going to tell you how it moves. And you can do tightly coupled now algorithm development, where you can measure motion flow from the picture and get also the accelerations from the IMU sensor.
And so you said this is 100 frames per second right now, so a global shutter will really help with like not getting any artifacts.
Yes, yes, exactly. So if you are in situations where, you know, you are moving the camera side to side, or you are trying to film vehicles going very fast, definitely the global shutter is going to help with that. Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
If people want to get involved somehow, how can they follow up on this?
So we have a website, jevois.org, where we publish updates there, and there is a lot of software development. We are very interested. I teach AI at USC, which is a very popular topic now. So I have usually about 600 students in my class, and many of them were very interested in this, so that they could develop their own algorithm.
Yeah.
So this is something that we are also, you know, very interested in helping out in any way we can. So there is like a question and answer, you know, open forum, on the website where you can ask any question. If you have programming questions, we can help you. It's basically as if, you know, you were coming to my office hour, but you don't have to move. You can stay at home and we'll help you out. Yeah. I think the video recordings, they can probably not see, but if they're interested in the slides and the material, I'm very happy to
share that. That's amazing. Thank you so much. This was so fascinating.
Excellent. Thanks for coming.